I did something horrible, something evil. I platformed a cyber criminal, a malware developer. I gave them a spotlight to show off their software and convince more people to use their malware. At least that's what you might think if you are from the Free Software Foundation. So recently they released this blog post, Our Small Team versus Millions of Bots. Now, the FSF, like Free Desktop and various other organizations out there, does a lot of web hosting, providing mirrors, GitForge hosting, and things like that. And this is not just for their own projects, but for other projects as well. And like most web services out there, especially ones with any sort of presence online or valuable data, they've been dealing with a scourge of DDoS attacks from, in many cases, very well-known and very reputable companies. DDoS attacks that you've probably heard about, even if you've never heard of the FSF. Not just your regular old DDoS, someone feels like doing something stupid, not just your regular old search engine web crawlers, which for the most part are pretty respectful with compute resources, but large language models or AI web crawlers. This is a problem that everybody is dealing with right now, and these are known to absolutely cripple websites, requiring either a lot more resources to keep the site online and usable, or you find some way to deal with the problem, some way to block the traffic so you don't have to deal with it any longer. Now, of course, like any big website, they still have to deal with your regular old DDoS attacks. In the full bulletin, we wrote about the August attack on GNU.org. That attack continues, but we have mitigated it. Judging from the pattern and scope, the goal was likely to take the site down, and it was not an LLM crawler. We do not know who or what is behind the attack, but since then, we've had more attacks with even higher severity. Furthermore, GNU.org and FTP.GNU.org were targets in a new DDoS attack starting on May 27th, 2025. Its goals seem to be to take the site down, it is currently mitigated, it has had several iterations, and each has caused some hours of downtime while we figured out how to defend ourselves against it. Here again, the goal was likely to take our sites down, and we do not know who or what is behind this. But that sort of stuff's always happened. Of course, you get the new kind as well. GNU Savannah, the FSF's collaborative software development system, was hit by a massive botnet controlling about 5 million IPs starting in January. As of this writing, the attack is still ongoing, but the botnet's current iteration is mitigated. The goal is likely to build an LLM training dataset. We do not know who or what is behind this. In addition, directory.fsf.org, the server behind the Free Software Directory, has been under attack since June 18. This is likely an LLM scraper designed to specifically target MediaWiki sites with a botnet. This attack is very active and now partially mitigated. Then you have things where they're not actually malicious, but they can become a problem if they're not handled in the correct way. Automated software build systems have become an issue for us. These usually go by the non-obvious term CICD, which stands for Continuous Integration or Continuous Deployment. They send automated requests to check for new code on Savannah in order to rebuild their software. They often send far more requests than is necessary, which looks and acts like a DDoS attack, even though it is not intended to be. It is intended to be building the latest software, building it consistently, ensuring that there's always an up-to-date build there. If it's done too much, though, and it's done by too many people, that can still cause an issue if you're not expecting to deal with that amount of traffic. We had to block some of these IP addresses, which often prompts them to search for better ways to accomplish the same goals. Now, if you're trying to circumvent the IP blocks, in a way, that does start to become malicious, especially if you try to keep doing the exact same thing. If the IP blocks prompt you to find a more productive way, a more healthy relationship between the two organizations, that's a good thing. Just so we're clear, especially when it comes to the LLMs, this is not something at all unique to the FSF. Every single thing online is dealing with this problem if the data it has is at all usable, which is gonna be the case for most websites.
in the tech space, GitHub, GitLab, the GNOME GitLab, the free desktop GitLab, the KDE GitLab, the KDE Bugzilla, all of these services are dealing with the exact same problem. Now, in the case of GitHub, you know, it's Microsoft, so they can throw as many resources at it as they want. Also, they are part of the problem, so, you know, they have the money to deal with it. When you're something like the KDE GitLab, like, you don't expect to be getting hit by hundreds of thousands or millions of extra requests that have nothing to do with developers interacting with the project. And in the FOSS world, there's been a recent trend of how to deal with this problem. If you know what it is, you know what it is, but we'll get to it in just a second, because now is where we get to the malware. When you visit a website, it might send your browser one or more JavaScript programs. I think in most cases, it's probably going to send you JavaScript. There's very few websites out there that you're actually going to actively visit that don't make use of any JavaScript. These JavaScript programs are usually proprietary. Most cases they are, even though, yes, you can see it, it is source available because it kind of has to be because it is being sent to your browser, but it is definitely not open source. If a website sends you a free JavaScript program, you can develop a modified version, share that with other people so they can benefit, and you can configure your browser to run your modified version instead of what the website sends. But some JavaScript programs are malware, which do things like spy on you, and the only modification any user would want is to stop it from ever running. That's totally fair. I don't think anyone's gonna argue that there aren't big companies that spy on users of their website. This is very well documented. You don't even have to be that much into the tech space to know this. And even if you don't do much about it, most people would probably say, I would rather not have that happen. Now, they might say things like, oh, I have nothing to hide, it doesn't bother me that much. But if you gave them the option of turning it off and nothing changes, most people would probably turn it off. So how are some devs dealing with the LLM problem? Well, a little program called Anubis. I don't know where this link is taking me, but it's certainly taking a long time to load. Is it actually going to do anything? I didn't test this beforehand. Maybe you might need Anubis, actually. I waited like 2 more minutes and it's still loading, so I feel like this link doesn't actually go anywhere. Anyway, this is Anubis. Weighs the soul of incoming HTTP requests to stop AI crawlers. This is just gobbledygook, doesn't actually mean anything. But yes, the purpose of this thing is to basically cut down on AI crawlers just smashing your website. As it says here, to decrease the amount of requests the automated systems send and therefore help the website avoid being DDoSed. I have gone and had Z on the podcast before. It was a very fun episode. I've also covered a couple of their blog posts. I don't think this one has been released yet, but I did do a video on this one? I think in my actual Anubis video, I did cover that one. But yes, really cool program. And if you go to something like Free Desktop and you see an anime girl there, that is why there is an anime girl there. And to this blog post, this is what Z had to say. If the FSF calls your program malware, is that a sign you've made it? Because yes, that is exactly what is about to happen. The problem is that Anubis makes the website send out a free JavaScript program that acts like malware. Now, there's a lot of things that act like malware, but aren't actually malware, especially when your malware definition is incredibly general. So I'll give them this one here, but let's keep going. A website using Anubis will respond to a request for a web page with a free JavaScript program and not the page that was requested. If you run the JavaScript program sent through Anubis, it will do some useless computations on random numbers and keep one CPU entirely busy. It could take less than a second or over a minute. When it is done, it sends the computation results back to the website. The website will verify that the useless computation was done by looking at the results and only then give access to the originally requested page. That's a pretty fair description. At the FSF, we do not support this scheme because it conflicts with the principles of software freedom. The Anubis JavaScript program's calculations are the same kind of calculations done by cryptocurrency mining programs, which is technically true, but also dishonest. First things first, Anubis is not crypto mining. Just get that out of the way. That is not what it is doing. What it is doing, though, is that useless computation is a proof-of-work calculation, and this is the same algorithm being used by Bitcoin. This is also absolutely true. However, the use in Anubis is actually closer to the original use of proof-of-work than it would be for Bitcoin, because Bitcoin didn't create proof of work, but it did certainly popularize it. It was actually created back in the 90s as an anti-spam mechanism in email. If you want to know more about that, go watch my original video on Anubis, or go look into the history of something known as Hashcash. I know Hashcash sounds like crypto. It's not crypto. This was years before Bitcoin actually existed. Also, it is a very interesting choice to try and use that against the Anubis project when the FSF does actually accept crypto donations. So, you know, stones in glass houses. Now, earlier it was stated that Anubis is like malware. Now we just come and outright say it. A program which does calculations that a user does not want is a form of malware. Proprietary software is often malware, and people often run it not because they want to, but because they have been pressured into it. If we made our website use Anubis, we would be pressuring users into running malware. So here we go, Anubis confirmed malware. Even though it is free software, it is part of a scheme that is far too similar to proprietary software to be acceptable. So it's not proprietary software, but because proprietary software often does similar things, therefore by association, it is bad. Right. We want users to control their own computing and to have autonomy, independence, and freedom. With your support, we can continue to put these principles into practice. And then it ends off by saying, hey, we have people working on these problems, we're trying to solve them, and also donate money. This post here basically perfectly sums up the entire... Why is it doing a redirect? Thank you. Anyway, this post here sums up exactly what the blog post was about. We're under attack by botnets and LLMs. We're under attack by botnets and LLMs. We're under attack by botnets and LLMs. We're under attack by botnets and LLMs and CI tests. This popular botnet and LLM blocker is malware. Donate now. Now, I understand the logic of this person at the FSF. I don't agree with the logic, but I do understand how you get to the position that Anubis is malware. When you want to have complete software freedom, and then there's something that comes along and says, hey, if you want to go to this thing, you have to run this thing on your computer. It's going to take CPU cycles. You don't want that to happen. And that feels malicious to you because, you know, you want to have freedom over your system. And when there is software that is malicious, that is malicious software, that is malware. I understand the leap shift to take to get here. But at the same time, when your definition of malware is this broad, it puts you into a situation where basically everything is malware. TLS is malware because not every website needs to have HTTPS. CSS is malware because not every website needs to have this fancy formatting, and the fancy formatting takes CPU cycles to render and generate. Software that is not perfectly mathematically optimized is malware because it is using CPU cycles that you don't want it to use. Literally everything is malware. And when your definition of malware is this broad and covers things which are not malware, like Anubis, when you try to call something malware, it makes your position a lot less reasonable. Because if you're calling all of this other stuff malware, And that's not malware. Why would people believe you when you say this other thing is? If you've been wrong 30 times already, why would your opinion be taken seriously on this one? To be very clear, just because I've criticized the FSF doesn't mean I hate them, but I do think there is a problem where they are way too deep into their mindset, so much so that they're even ignoring good free software solutions to a problem they have, because it's not a perfect solution. What I think would be a good way to deal with this is implement something like Anubis temporarily, work towards a better solution that you want to be using, remove Anubis, and then go to that solution. But they don't seem to want to take a little step in the right direction. They want to take a giant leap all at once. So, what do you think? Do you think Anubis is malware? Do you think this is just... this is just a massive overreach? And what do you think of Anubis just showing up on random FOSS websites? Do you think it's really annoying? Do you like it being there, knowing what it's being used for? I'd love to know. So if you liked the video, go like the video. If you really liked the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, leave a verified link in the description down below. That's going to be it for me and... Fox Girls. What is this?